I want to do some teaching this morning on some basic foundational truths found in the scripture. Why do we celebrate Christmas? Amen? I know that no one knows the exact date that Christ was born. We know that we celebrated on December 25th. But there's some people that say, no, it happened in April during the lambing season. Others say it happened in September. In my opinion, I'm just glad he was born. Amen. It doesn't matter.
No.
It's kind of like the tribulation period when people say, are you pre, mid, or post? I tell them, well, let's see, in the old days I wrote a panhead, so I think I'm a pan-tribulationist. And I said, what does that mean? And I said, I think it'll just all pan out. Because only the Father knows. Amen. And only the Father knows the exact day. But I'm glad we have a day that we can celebrate and pick out and shout out the name of Jesus to the whole world. Amen? So this morning I just want to share, why do we celebrate Christmas? Okay, we have to go all the way back to the Garden of Eden. So would you turn with me to Genesis chapter 2, if you would? We have to go all the way back to the Garden of Eden. You say, oh man, I hope he's not going to read the whole Bible today. Okay, we're going to start Genesis chapter 2 and verse 4. These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. That's Genesis 2 and verse 4. If you have the same kind of Bible I do, it's on page 3. All right, verse 5. And every plant of the field before it was in the earth, and every herb of the field before it grew, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was not a man to till the ground. But there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. Kind of like a drip system, only God put that all together where it's perfect. Verse 7. And then the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Our soul is our mind, our will, and our emotions. That's who we really are. We're contained in this body, but this body's going to go away. Somebody said, man, what happens when people get old? I said, I think it's gravity. This is... Everything kind of falls down, but so we can go up. Yeah, God never intended us for us to be here forever. He intended for us to have fellowship with him forever. And so the Lord God did form man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Verse 8. And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. Verse 9. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life he put also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from thence it was parted and became into four heads. The name of the first one is Pison. That is which compasses the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold, and the gold of that land is good. And there is Delium and onyx stones there, and the name of the second river is Gihon, the same it is that compasses the whole land of Ethiopia. And the name of the third river is Hiddekel, and that is which goes toward the east of Assyria, and the fourth river is Euphrates. And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat. Isn't God good? But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. So I want to talk about death for just a minute. Death is not what we think death is. We think death is when someone gives up their last breath and their body grows cold. That's not death. That's separation. That's separating the soul from the body. The soul lives forever. What death is to be separated from God for eternity. That's what death is. And that's what God meant when he said, when the day that you eat of it, you'll surely die. He said, the day that you disobey me and you become knowledgeable of good and evil, you'll be separated from me. Because only God has the wisdom and the power and the knowledge to read the heart of every human being on this earth to know what is good and what is evil. We make up our own rules about good and evil. So he said, he went on to say, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you will not eat of it, for in the day that you eat of it, you will surely die. And the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper or a helpmeet for him. And out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them to Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. Can you imagine? I've heard that there's over 10,000 species of just birds. Can you imagine being so sharp in your mind that God could bring all these creatures before you and you could say, that's a bird. This is an aardvark. This is a giraffe. This is a lion. And there's so many species of animals. And yet God gave Adam a mind to be able to name all of them. And Adam gave names to all the cattle and to the fowl of the air and to every beast of the field. For Adam, there was not found a helpmeet for him. The Bible says elsewhere, it is not good for man to be alone. It is not good. And so the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from the man, he made a woman and brought her to the man. You can only imagine what Adam thought. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. You know, I've always thought about it this way. When a man and a woman come together, the Bible says they're one flesh. Flesh is something you can feel. So what do you think your children are? They're a picture of the one flesh that you and your mate are. That's exactly what children are a picture from God of one flesh coming together. Amen? Mm-hmm. So it goes on to say, and they were both naked, and the man and his wife, and they were not ashamed. Now the serpent, okay, so I need to park right there. The Bible tells us in Isaiah chapter 14 and in Ezekiel chapter 28 that Satan, his original name was Lucifer, and he was the praise angel in heaven. There were three main angels. There was a warring angel or a fighting angel named Michael, the archangel, and there was another angel named Gabriel, who is the angel that God uses to make announcements and blow trumpets, especially during the last days on this earth. And there was another angel named Lucifer, and Lucifer was in charge of all the praise and worship in heaven. And Lucifer's place was in the sides of the north where God's throne was, and he brought forth angels to praise him day and night. The Bible tells us in Ezekiel 14 and Ezekiel chapter 28, and I mean Isaiah 14 and Ezekiel 28, I wish we had time to go through it, but it boils down to this. And Lucifer said in his heart, I'm going to be like the Most High God. I'm going to take my angels and go to the sides of the north where God is. And I'm going to rise above the stars of God, the throne of God, and I'm going to be. And when that happened, God threw Lucifer out of heaven. The Bible records that in Luke chapter 10, and I believe it's verse 19, where Jesus, before that, had sent out 70 disciples to go out and heal the sick, heal the lame, do all the miracles that he had been doing. And the 70 disciples returned, and I think it's around Luke 10, 18, where it says, and the 70 returned with great joy, saying, Lord, even the spirits are subject unto us through thy name. And Jesus said, behold, I saw Satan fall from heaven like lightning. And you know, if you've ever been in Colorado or Utah when they have lightning storms, I was born and raised in Utah, man, that lightning just flashes across the whole sky. It's there for about half a second and then it's gone. Just kaboom, like that. That's how fast Lucifer, now named Satan, the devil, that old serpent, and the dragon, was cast down from heaven to earth. Now at that time, the earth was dark, it was without form, it was void, it was empty. And that's why Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 tells us that in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the Spirit of the Lord moved across the face of the deep. And then God said, let there be light. So this planet was the dwelling place of the devil that had been thrown out of heaven. But God's hand moved across the sky. He spoke his word and said, let there be light. And then God had all this creation made. He made all the cattle, all the birds, all the fish, all the trees, all the fruit, all the plants, all the trees. And then he made Adam, and then he made Eve. And that's how we got here. How does that answer the question, why do we celebrate Christmas? Of course, I'm not going to tell a 10-year-old this. I'm going to break all this down. But it's good to be reminded of where we came from. You know, the verse that I read, forget not all his benefits, Psalm 103, verse 2. Let's not forget all of God's benefits. Amen? So the serpent, which was cast down from heaven to earth because of his pride. Don't let anyone fool you. He did not say, I will be like God. He thought it. And God read his heart. You ask, well, how did all those angels follow him? I believe because he thought it, he deceived them as well into thinking just what he's going to purport here to Adam and Eve in the book of Genesis. Well, God just knows that you want to be like him. And you surely won't die. We'll read the story. He was more tricky than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God said, you will not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, oh, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it. Neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said to the woman, you shall not surely die. Do you know that that lie is still being purported all throughout the earth? Oh, you're not going to die. God wouldn't do that. A loving God would never separate you from his presence. He would never do that. Now, my Bible tells me the wages of sin is death. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, not even one. There is not one good man on this earth that does good and does not sin. We go on in chapter 3. The woman said to the serpent, we can eat all the trees of the garden, but the tree that's in the middle of the garden, God said, don't eat it or touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said, you'll not die. For God knows that in the day that you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, now this is interesting because in 1 John chapter 2, starting with verse 15, the scripture says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For all that is in the world, it's not of the Father, but it's of the world. The lust of the eyes, what we see. The pride of life, what we can become. And the lust of the flesh, all the evil things we can desire, are not of the Father, but they're of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust thereof. But he that does the will of God abides forever. So the first thing Eve did was love what she saw. the lust of the eyes, the evil desires of the eyes. She looked on the tree and saw it was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree that was to be desired to make one wise. There's the pride of life. So she took of the fruit and ate it. Now I want to park right there, because I think women have gotten a really bad rap in Genesis. Okay? If it wasn't for Eve, we wouldn't be there. I got to tell you, it wasn't about Eve. If you read the scripture, the Bible says, "For one by one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so that death passed upon all men, for all have sinned." What happened to Eve? Eve got deceived. What happened to Adam? Have you ever watched TV and seen that commercial about the cereal where the three little kids are sitting around the table and mom brings out a new cereal, pours it in the bowls, and the two older kids are looking around like, "We're not eating this." And then here's Mikey, the little kid, and they said, "Let Mikey try it." So Mikey gets to eat the cereal and he really likes it, and then the other kids eat it. That's exactly what Adam did to Eve. If you want to read it again, here it is. "And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant," this is verse 6 in chapter 3, "to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit and she ate it. And she gave it also to her husband with her and forced him to eat it." Nope, that was his choice. He ate it willingly. Now I want to park right there to take you to Romans chapter 5 and verse 12 so you understand what happened at that point. Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. Keep your hand in chapter 3. Romans 5 and verse 12 says this: "Wherefore by one man, sin entered into the world, and death came by sin. So death passed upon all men, for all have sinned." You say, "Well, if I'd have been Adam, I wouldn't have done that." Yeah, you would have. And I would have too. I might have even done it earlier. I might have took the fruit first. I just know that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And that there's none righteous, not even one. And there's not even a good man on this earth that does good and never sins. Not one. So why is it that we judge each other? Because we ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and now we think we're the judge. And we're not the judge. Only God can see the heart. Only God knows the heart. Man, think about that thief on the cross. All he said was, "Lord, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He never paid anybody back from the things he stole. He never said he was sorry from the cross. He never said, "I need to get down from here and go restore that which I stole." He just recognized that Jesus was Lord. And he said, "Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom." And Jesus said unto him, "Today thou shalt be with me in paradise." Look at the mercy of God. So if you're still in Romans 5, there's two other verses I want to look at. Verses 8 and 9. And it says this: "But God showed his love towards us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Let's not forget all of his benefits. Christ died in my place. Just like we have the military going all over the world trying to protect us and defend us from evil from coming into our country, Jesus came from heaven to earth to pay for me. You know, I used to think on the cross, when he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do," I thought, yeah, those dirty Romans, the Italians, you know. Thank God it wasn't Greeks, you know. And I thought, you know what? I think he was talking to me. You're talking to me. Yeah, he was talking to me, and he was talking to you. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." The guilt was on all of us. Roman soldiers never put Jesus on the cross. Jesus put Jesus on the cross. John chapter 10 says, "No man takes my life from me. I lay it down and I take it back again. This commandment have I received from my Father. Jesus himself laid his life down for us. He came on his own. The Bible says in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not think it robbery to be equal with God, but he himself instead made himself of no reputation and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Jesus, it was all about Jesus. It wasn't about the Romans. It wasn't about Adam and Eve. It was all about Jesus. Do you know, I believe while they were tromping through the garden towards that tree, Jesus was making preparations to go to Calvary. Because God knows all things. He knew everything that was going to happen. And while Adam and Eve were stepping through the leaves in the garden towards the tree, and they were together, because the Bible said she gave her husband with her, as they were tromping through those leaves and coming to the tree, I believe with all my heart, Jesus was preparing himself to go to Calvary. Can I prove that to you in the Bible?
Yeah.
I will in just a second. I have to finish the story. Once they ate, the eyes of them were both opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. You know, people are still doing that today. Rather than accepting the robe of righteousness of Jesus Christ, like Isaiah 61:10 says, he will clothe me with the robe of righteousness, people try to make their own robe. I'm a good person. I can just get into some religion that helps me to do good things for people, and that should be good enough. There's a problem with that. Isaiah 64 and verse 6 says, we have all together gone out of the way. All of our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. There's nothing we can do to earn our way to go to heaven. The book of Titus, which Paul wrote, says this to the church, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to God's mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration, that's the blood of Christ, and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. And I want to talk to you about that before I get to the other answer. How did he renew the Holy Ghost? We had the Holy Spirit in the Garden of Eden. The Bible says the Spirit of God walked in the cool of the day with Adam and Eve and talked with them. We had, through Adam and Eve, the Holy Spirit. But when Adam sinned, and Eve was deceived, we lost the Holy Spirit of God. There became a separation. Let's read about that. Genesis chapter 3. The eyes of them were both opened, verse 7. And they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. Adam and his wife, they hid themselves in the presence of the Lord in the trees of the garden. Let's hide from God. Really? Verse 9. And the Lord God called to Adam and said, where art thou? Where were you? You don't think God knew where they were? That's God's mercy. I know you're hiding. You know, don't you love it when little kids do this? You can't see me. And you play along with them. You know, the fact of it is God sees everything we do. He knows everything we are. He knows the motives of our hearts. He knows everything, every pain and every suffering that we go through. God knows all about it. God was being merciful when he said, where are you? I'm giving you a chance to come clean, Adam. You know, I know where you are, but will you step forward? Verse 10, he said, well, I heard your voice in the garden and I was afraid. Because I was naked, so I hid myself. And he said, who told you that you're naked? Have you eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou should not eat? And the man said, here we go. It's like what I said, we blame the women. The woman that you gave me, oh, no, no, let's blame God instead. You gave her to me, right? You're the one that gave her to me. It's your fault, God, that I'm here. Read it. There it is. And the man said, the woman that you gave me, she gave me of the tree and I ate it. And the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? And the woman said, well, the serpent tricked me. This is why we have psychologists. Okay. Trying to get us to see that it's us. Look in the mirror. I'm a sinner. And by God's grace, I'm saved. We want to blame so much on everything around us instead of really understanding that it is all about between us and God. And our outward circumstances don't matter. Because Jesus went through every circumstance that we could ever go through. The Bible says, and we are not touched with the infirmities of a high priest who can't, who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. For he was tempted in every way, yet like we are, but he was yet without sin. So Jesus understands everything about us. And so the man blames the woman blames the snake, and God puts a stop to all of it. He might as well have said, everybody look in the mirror. And the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field, and upon your belly shall you go, and dust shall you eat all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed, and it shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. That's why we have all the attacks we have from the enemy in our world. He's constantly bruising our heel. But he, the seed of David, Jesus, will bruise his head, according to the scripture. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception, and in sorrow you will bring forth children, and your desire will be to your husband, and he will rule over you. How many here like to be ruled over? Man, I don't. You know, I used to go to a church where the preacher all he did was yell and point his finger. And it was especially intimidating because he did two or three steps up and then pointed. You know, who wants to go to church on Sunday morning and get yelled at? I don't. You know, I'd rather be out in the woods somewhere worshiping the Lord than get yelled at. The Bible says that pastors, evangelists, teachers, prophets, and apostles are sent to the church to build the church up, to teach the church, so that the church, which the pastors are part of too, so the church can do the work of the ministry. And the work of the ministry is to do what Jesus said. This is a new, John 13, 34 and 35, this is a new commandment I give you, that you should love one another, even as I have loved you. So also ought ye to love one another. And by this shall all men see that you are my disciples, if you have love one to another. Now, how do you love people? Well, there's times you got to pull them out of the fire. If you love them, if you see them going off a cliff, you have to pull them back so that they won't go off the cliff. And then there's times that you feed people. There's times that you put your arms around people. That happened this morning. One of our sisters needed prayer for her son. And one of our other sisters in the Lord went and sat next to her and prayed for her, put her arms around her, and comforted her. That's what the body of Christ looks like. It's not a bunch of yelling and screaming. It's a bunch of encouraging that we should continue on in the ways of God. So back in Genesis 3, unto Adam he said, because you listened to the voice of your wife, and you've eaten of the tree which I commanded you, saying, you shall not eat of it. By the way, we were supposed to be protecting. Adam was supposed to be watching over and protecting. And when Eve decided to go her own way, Adam stood by and watched it and let the devil trick her. But he willingly ate of it. He knew exactly what was going on. He said, because of it, cursed is the ground for your sake. In sorrow, you're going to eat of it all of your days, all the days of your life. And thorns and thistles it will bring forth to you, and you will eat the herb of the field. And in the sweat of your face, you will eat bread until you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and unto dust shall you return. The Bible says Adam called his wife Eve because she was the mother of all living. Unto Adam also, unto his wife, did the Lord God make coats of skins and clothe them. Did you ever wonder about that? Remember, they took fig leaves and sewed them together and tried to cover themselves up, and God said, not good enough. Because the wages of sin is death. So God had to take the life of animals in order not to take away, but to cover their sin. A life had to go for a life. The wages of sin is death. So God had to take the life of animals in order to cover the love of his life, his created creatures, Adam and Eve. He had to take the life of an animal in order to cover that sin. Don't forget his benefits, because our sin isn't covered anymore. It's taken away. It's completely taken away. Jesus, when he came, was the Lamb of God, the spotless, sinless Lamb of God, who takes away, John 1:29, the sins of the world. He took them away. Forget not all his benefits. So why do we celebrate Christmas? Well, you may not be aware of this, but they had a meeting in heaven about this. It's in Psalm 85. So if you look in Psalm 85 with me, because I would imagine that over the Christmas season, there might be people to say, might ask you, Christina, might ask you, Kimberly, why do we celebrate Christmas? Now you can tell them intelligently why it is that we celebrate Christmas, the coming of Christ. Why do we celebrate that? Well, the Bible says in Psalm 85, starting with verse 7, show us thy mercy, O Lord, and grant us thy salvation. I didn't finish the rest of the story in Genesis, but God had to kick Adam and Eve out of the garden. They were no longer in the presence of the Lord. And God put flaming swords at the entrance through cherubim who were standing at the entrance of the Garden of Eden to guard the way so that they couldn't come back in. Why do you think God did that? Was he just being mean and saying, now you're going to have to grow your own fruit? The Lord did not want them to eat from the tree of life. And then forever and ever, they would have lived in sin. But God blocked their way. Look at God's mercy. God blocked their way from any more rebellion than what they had already been in, and kicked them out of the garden. And ever since that time, you know the story of Cain and Abel? Ever since that time, instead of loving one another, we've been killing one another. Ever since that time, we've been killing one another with words and with swords. And God says these things ought not to be so. So there was a meeting in heaven. This is a great meeting. Verse 8 says, I will hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace unto his people and to his saints, but let them not turn again to folly. Verse 9. Surely his salvation is near those who fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. The meeting in heaven was all about, we want glory to still dwell on the earth. We know that man gave up his authority over Satan when he sinned. We know that man gave that authority and didn't get it back till Jesus came back. That same chapter, remember Luke 10:18, where Jesus said, I beheld, I saw Satan fall from heaven like lightning. The next verse says, behold, I give you power. That word power in the Greek is the Greek word exousia, which means authority. So God says, I give you authority now over serpents and over scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Amen?
Amen?
Forget not all his benefits. Our names are written in heaven. We have eternal life. Should we not celebrate? I remember when I was in the Navy, you get bored, especially when you're stuck on the base. So we'd turn on the TV and watch the football games. And a lot of times in the winter, we would see these crazy people, like in Minnesota, that had no shirt on. It's like 21 degrees outside. And then have some ridiculous saying painted on their chest They'd be jumping up and down. People would be spilling beer on them. Really? You know, and you know what they were rejoicing about? Over some poor little pig that had to get his life so that they could take the ball, so they could kick it around on the field and show everybody how big and tough they are. And I thought, you know, it's amazing to me how these people who stood out in a 21-degree weather with no shirt on. Hey, I was born and raised in Utah. It gets cold there. It got down into the 20s, and man, I had a shirt, coat, another coat over that, galoshes, gloves, hat, boots, everything, and I still couldn't stay warm. These clowns are out there with no shirt on? Really? Over a pigskin ball? You gotta be kidding me. Why is it that we can't rejoice over the thing that we're happiest about? Why is it that we can't go overboard like that and praise God and say glory to God and hallelujah for what he's bought for us by his blood? Man, if the world can rejoice like that without a shirt on, surely we can wear a shirt and rejoice. It's amazing to me. So this meeting happened. Here's what happened in the meeting, verse 10, Psalm 85, 10. Mercy and truth met together. Truth said, that's it. Adam and Eve have transgressed the law, Father God. They're done. The wages of sin is death. It's written in your word. You told them if you touch that tree, if you eat it, you're going to die. They have to die. That's truth. Mercy said, Father, we're not willing that anyone should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Please don't let them die. Mercy and truth met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Righteousness said, the wages of sin is death. We are a holy God, cannot allow sin into heaven. They can never be with us again because of sin. Peace said, let's send the Prince of Peace, Isaiah 9:6. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The government shall be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Isaiah 7:14 says, behold, a virgin shall conceive and bring forth a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, God with us. God's plan was so awesome. They had this meeting in heaven. Verse 11 says, truth will spring out of the earth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He sprang, Psalm 139 says, out of the lowest parts of the earth, out of Mary's womb. Not from Joseph, but from the Holy Spirit. The virgin birth prophesied in Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14. That's why we celebrate Christmas. We celebrate Christmas because I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. I praise God for our salvation. I praise God that he has mercy. I praise God that I don't have to do it on my own. I already proved that in the garden. We can't do it on our own. Even Adam and Eve tried to cover it up. Trying to make fig leaves, and I'm sure they probably had it like a Bernina sewing machine or something, where they could do a really good job. The fact of it is, it wasn't good enough for God. The Bible says, not by works, Titus chapter 3 and verse 5, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. He washed us with the washing of regeneration, his blood, and renewing of the Holy Ghost. The Bible says that by grace we are saved through faith. It's not of ourselves. It's a gift from God. Somebody was thinking, oh, here's the time when he passes out money. Not going to happen today. It's a gift from God, not of works, so that no one can boast. So that no one can boast. Because that's what we do. That's part of 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, the pride of life. Look what I've done. Look what I'm doing. Look what I will do. The Bible says, boast not yourself of tomorrow, for a man does not know what a day will bring forth. James says, for what is our life? It is even a vapor that appears. appears for a little while and then vanishes away. We only have but this moment in time to thank our God for what he's done for us. Think about this meeting in heaven. Mercy and truth met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. And truth sprang out of the earth. Jesus. Jesus sprang out of the earth in the form of a baby, not considering it robbery to be equal with God, but instead he made himself of no reputation, made himself trust that Mary would feed him, that Joseph and Mary would nurture him and help him to grow up, fully knowing as he got older that he was God in the flesh. God in the flesh. You know, I had some people who belong to a cult come to my front door. And you know, one of the things that the Bible teaches in 1 Timothy is the servant of the Lord must not fight. He must be gentle. Teaching those who oppose themselves, peradventure, God would give them acknowledging to repent and accept the truth so that they can recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by the devil at his will. And so God wants us to minister to these people, not turn them away. And they'll come to my door and they'll give me their 2 or 3 or 4 minute speech, and I listen and I try to find something positive to say to them. And then I ask a question. A lot better to ask questions than make statements. Remember John in heaven when all the people showed up on heaven's floor and the elders said, "Who are all these people? Where did they come from?" John said, "I don't know. Do you?" You know, it's better to ask a question. So I just say, you know, I have this question. And nobody's ever been able to answer it. But maybe you can answer it, since it seems like you know so much about the Bible. And since you're the only right people on the earth, maybe you can answer this question for me. Here we have in Luke chapter 10, 70 disciples going out and ministering, healing, praying for the sick, demons cast out. They come back and they tell Jesus, "Even the spirits, the demonic spirits, are subject to us through your name." Yep, that's right. That's right there in the Bible. Amen. You know what he said? "I saw Satan fall from heaven like lightning." My question is, how old do you think Jesus was when he said that? Well, the Bible says that it was between 30 and 33 years age that he ministered. So can you explain to me how a 30-year-old man saw something that happened over 4,000 years before that? 4,000 plus. We know 4,000 till creation, but we don't know how long before that Satan got thrown out of heaven. So at least 4,000 years before Satan was thrown out of heaven, how can a 30-year-old man see that with his eyes? Unless he's God. This meeting, truth sprang out of the earth. Righteousness looked down from heaven. That's the Father. The Father looked down from heaven, saw his Son coming into the world through the means of Bethlehem. "Yea, the Lord shall give that which is good," verse 12. "And our land will yield her increase." It's God's expectation that we grow. That we grow in grace, that our land, which we're made out of the dust of the earth, will grow in righteousness, and that there'll be more souls coming to know him through us growing in righteousness. Amen? And then in verse 13, "Righteousness shall go before him, and shall set us in the way of his steps." I want to encourage you this morning. Why we celebrate Christmas? Of Jesus Christ and his great mercy and his great love. He loves us far more than we can ever imagine. I love what it says in Jeremiah 31:3. God says, "I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have drawn you with loving kindness." You know, I've prayed and I've said, "Lord, is there ever going to be a day when I'm not going to mess up? I mean, is there ever going to be a day when I'm driving in Santa Maria, okay, and somebody's not going to shoot across three lanes of traffic and cut me off so I go sideways?" Mm-hmm. And the Lord said, nope. Long as there's sin in the world, nope. But the good news is found in almost the last book of the Bible. If you'll turn there with me, and we're going to close there. Jude, the book of Jude. Right before the book of Revelation, God puts this little one-page book in there to remind us of his goodness. And he tells us in verse 20, Jude, I guess you could say chapter 1, it's the only chapter. Jude, verse 20. But you, beloved, isn't it awesome that God calls us beloved? After all we've done, he calls us to be beloved. Building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Get a hold of God so deeply that you're not even sure what you're praying. Whether it's through tears, or praying in tongues, or weeping before the Lord, whatever it is, praying in the Holy Ghost. Keeping yourselves in the love of God, even while you're driving in Santa Maria. Oh, that might have been a word for me, actually. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Keep on looking, because he's coming. The signs are everywhere. Man, we would have to be blind not to see what's going on in the world. He's coming soon, isn't he, Troy?
Yep.
I know you're disappointed every week when you get up here. It's just, well, one more week. But brother, that's good. Because the Bible says we should always be watching and we should always be ready. Verse 22, on some have compassion. That will make a difference. You know, the Bible says a soft tongue or a soft answer turns away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. And then the Bible goes on to say in Proverbs that a soft tongue breaks the bone. It's so true. Have compassion, and that will make a difference on some. Others, verse 23, you have to save them with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even their garments that are polluted by sin or spotted by the flesh. What does that mean? I was at Vandenberg Air Force Base in 1980. It was probably around February, because I got saved in November of 1980. And there was this military security policeman who carried a machine gun, and he kept witnessing to me and sharing Jesus with me. And one day, I just flipped out. I told him, I don't want to hear that no more. I don't want to hear that name anymore. That name turned something up inside of me, and I don't want to hear it. And I really got upset. And most believers, I think, would say at that point, okay, I'll respect your desires. I won't talk to you anymore about Jesus. You know what John did? John pulled me out of the fire. He said, do you realize where you're going to spend eternity by making that choice? And he shared with me some verses out of Scripture about hell. No one had ever done that before. And after I went home that night, I knew I was going to hell. And John tried to pull me, John Offerman tried to pull me out of the fires of hell. That's what the Bible says. On some, have compassion. That'll make a difference. Others, you have to save them with fear. Pulling them out of the fire. I hate to say this, but there's a lot of people standing behind these things these days that refuse to talk about the fire. Why would you not warn people about a fire? Don't you think it's prophetic that we have fires just to the south of us? And I got a warrant, three warnings last night. One at 2:32, another one at 4-something, and another one at 7-something this morning that woke me up out of sleep. Man, you think I'm nuts? You're right. I got up, got in my robe, and went outside in the middle of the street to look and see if the fire was coming. And thank God it was 2:32. You know, because my neighbors would have went, and he's supposed to be a preacher, really? Man, I was looking because I got a warning on my phone that said, evacuate, evacuate. It wasn't until later that they gave the details. Shouldn't we say evacuate to those who don't know him? Shouldn't we warn them about the fires that are coming? You know, God's given us a physical picture of what's going to happen in the spirit. Shouldn't we warn them like the Bible says? I like verse 24. Man, how am I going to make it through this mess? I mean, the world's going nuts. People are crazy. They're shooting one another, running each other off the road. They won't even let you in the grocery line if you just have one item anymore. You know, they used to. I'd say, excuse me, ma'am. I just have this one little bitty thing, and you have like four carts full. Could I just? No. Fine, then I'll steal it. Just kidding. Unfortunately, that's on tape now. There'll be a sign in front of Albertson's, "You're not welcome." Verse 24. Who's going to help me make it through this mess? I can't. I'm not strong enough. I wish I could help you through this mess, but the only way I know how is to point you to the one who can help you out of this mess. I can't do anything for you other than just give you what God says and ask you to turn your eyes upon Jesus and look full in his wonderful face. That's all I can do. And that's all God wants me to do. Because we're not the Savior. He is. Verse 24 says this, "Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling." Hallelujah. God is able to keep me from falling. The Bible says a just man, a good man, will fall 7 times, but will rise up again. Why will he rise up again? Because of a good God. Because it's the good God that helps him to rise up again. "Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless." Okay, so please don't lie this morning. How many faultless people do we have in here? Zero. Good. Nobody raised their hand. We all have faults. We're all faultless. One of my biggest faults is looking at my watch and gives you the false impression that that means something. Doesn't mean anything. Faultless before his throne. So think about this. I know what I've done. I have no idea what you've done. It's none of my business. And if God were Italian, he would say it's none of your business. Okay? None of your business. None of my business. My business is to love you and encourage you to look at the one who can keep you faultless and keep you from falling. Because someday Jesus is going to step into heaven with us in front of him, and he's going to say, "This is my servant. He's faultless." And the Father's going to say, "I receive it." We know we're not faultless, but Jesus is faultless. And his blood covers us and took our sin away. So I started this morning. Oh, I want to finish that verse. "Unto him be the glory forever and ever. Amen."
Amen.
Forever and ever. So I want to finish what I started this morning. I think you know why we celebrate Christmas now, but Psalm 103, if you'll go back. We celebrate the goodness of Christ. Just how good is he? Well, I read the first two verses of Psalm 103. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Forget not all of his benefits." And he brings this list all the way down to verse 14. "Who forgives all our iniquities." All is all. Forgives all. You mean to tell me that Jesus hung on that cross and saw everything I would do before I got saved, while I was saved, to the end of my life and said, I choose him. Yes. That's exactly what Jesus did. That's exactly what he did. He leaves it to us to believe, to totally, completely rely upon the truth that he's also given us in his word. He leaves it to us. It's not a license to sin. If you have Christ within you and you realize his great mercy and his great love, that pushes us more not to sin. Although we know we will because we're human, there's no excuse for that. God covers it and he takes it away. That's what he says. Who forgives all your iniquities and heals all your diseases. Who has redeemed your life from destruction. Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies. I'll tell you a story. Talking about tender mercy. There were three or four of us bikers that got saved around the same time. So we all sat in the same row together. And I called it the Marine Corps Baptist Church. Everybody wore a suit and tie. Everybody had their hair cut a certain way. And then we walk in. You know, and it was like, we look different than everybody else. Oh, yeah, we looked way different. But God's tender mercy continued to work with us. And so there was one buddy of mine, Steve Gallardo. He's in heaven now. But Brother Steve, man, had a million questions. I did not realize that God was using Steve to teach me the Bible. He would ask all these questions all the time. And I would think, like, do I ever get any peace here? You know, so I'd have to go home and study so I could come back and say, well, this is what that really meant and show me. And God used Steve to teach me the Bible. And I'd complain all the time, you know, and say, man, I wish you'd quit bugging me. Why didn't he bug you, Eric? You know, I don't know why he was bugging me. I guess God was calling me and I didn't hear it. So one day at home, and my little baby's sleeping, and my wife's downstairs, and I'm up in my office, and I hear a ring on the bell, so I go to the window and look out, and it's Steve. I'm thinking, is this that scripture that says, the wicked have no peace? You know, I can't even have peace in my home? So I yell down the stairs and say, tell him I'm not here. And she said, I'm not going to lie for you. And I said, well, tell him I'm in the shower. So I turned on the shower. So a couple minutes later, I'm listening and I don't hear any voices downstairs. Maybe he left. Maybe he got offended. He didn't get offended. When I went downstairs, she handed me a beautifully wrapped present with the card. We're talking about tender mercy here. See, a lot of times we expect the baseball bat. God's just saying, batter up. Go ahead, mess up, see what happens. That's not our God. Our God sometimes draws us with the tender mercy, even though we deserve something a little bit more. And so I open this card and it just says, Greg, we've done a lot of crazy stuff together, but I thank my God upon every remembrance of you that you have helped me to know Jesus through studying the Bible. Thank you. So I unwrap the present, and it's a beautiful, full leather-bound New Testament with my name engraved on it. Best spanking I ever got. It hurt so good, and it helped me to remember there's a Father up above who's looking down in love. Be careful what you do, what you say, what you see. He redeems my life from destruction and crowns me with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies my mouth with good things, so that my youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. If you're oppressed today, God is in the process of executing righteousness and judgment to get you out of your oppression. He made known his ways to Moses and his acts to the children of Israel, because the Lord is merciful. That means full of mercy. He He's full of mercy. He's gracious. He's slow to anger. Thank God. Because I push him to the limit sometimes. He's slow to anger. And plenteous in mercy. He will not always chide. Neither will he keep his anger forever. You know how sometimes families get in a fight? I'm not talking to them. It's been 10 years. It's like, really? God doesn't do that. He has not dealt with us after our sins. He has not rewarded us according to our iniquities. Thank God. Thank God. Hi, Alan. Me and him know. Thank God you guys don't know. For the heaven is high above the earth, as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy towards them that fear him. So let's bring the idea of that. So we have three heavens, the air we breathe, the stars we see, and where God lives. Where God lives is so far we can't see it. We can see kind of to the end of our little galaxy here, but there's billions of them. And past all of those is where God's heaven is. As high as the heaven is above the earth, so great is his mercy towards those who fear him. Like a father who pities his children, the Lord pities those who fear him. Because he remembers how we were made. He remembers our frame. He remembers that we are dust. That brings us right back to Genesis chapter 2. Out of the dust of the earth, he formed man. We are so blessed to have our Heavenly Father. We are so blessed to be saved. We are so blessed to know Jesus. Let's celebrate him. Let the people know that he alone is God. Amen? Would you stand with me? Father, I want to thank you for your great mercy. For myself. And for my brothers and sisters that are in this room. You are an amazing Father, the likes of which we have never seen in flesh on this earth. You are amazing. And we love you, Lord. And we rejoice and celebrate. And Lord, we know the 25th of December is a day that we've set apart, that's all. It's just a day that's sanctified, set apart, to let the whole world know that Jesus is Lord. Even as your word says, after you humbled yourself and became obedient to death, even the death on a cross, that you highly exalted your son, Jesus, and have given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee would bow of things in heaven and things on earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue would confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. We proclaim you as Lord, and we love you, and we thank you for your great sacrifice. And now, Lord, you said in your word, these signs will follow those who believe in me. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. And so, Lord, I pray as I invite those who are hurting this morning, maybe it's a physical illness, Father, maybe it's a spiritual illness. Perhaps it's a burden for a loved one who doesn't know you. Whatever it is, Father, I pray you'll move among your people, because we all have the Holy Spirit, and we can all minister in the name of Jesus. I pray you will move, Father, as those who have need. I invite you to come forward and receive prayer for whatever it is that is in your spirit this morning that you need prayer for. And Father, I thank you as those come that you will gather this body of Christ around them to to minister love and peace. We'll give you thanks and praise forever and ever. Standing before your throne, we will bow down and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, for you alone are worthy. We love you, Lord, and we give you praise. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Let's give him praise this morning.